Hey everybody, thanks for being here. This week, we're at the mouth of the Deschutes River and the mouth of the Klickitat River on the Columbia, hover fishing for fall run Chinook salmon. If you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television.
So we're getting a really early start on it this morning. It's about 4 o'clock and we met at 4 and now we're up here at 5. Main reason for that is just to get easy in and out with the boat ramp and find a place to park. And now we're gonna head up and go up right by the mouth of the Deschutes and spot lock it until it gets light. Just get our baits ready and get everything dialed in.
Hands down, this is my favorite fishery of all of them. I mean, just holding the rod, feeling the bite, setting the hook. It's just my favorite.
So we're up here at the mouth of the Deschutes and they have a cold water sanctuary inside of these boundary markers. So right here at the Dolphin, we usually start just down below that and could just kind of skirt along that boundary. And it's good depth all the way down. It starts out shallower up here and kind of drops down as you go down. And these fish will keg up here pretty good just because of this cold water confluence from the Deschutes River. So that's kind of why we start out here, and hopefully it's as productive as it can be.
Usually when I'm on the Deschutes, I'm either upriver casting spinners for steelhead or fishing redsides, fly fishing. So I was here probably maybe 15 or 20 years ago, had a blast, but I certainly am on a learning curve today.
We got sand shrimp, two different flavors of eggs, and we'll get everything cut up into baits and hopefully figure out what they're looking for.
These ones here are fuse. We got a few different cures with us today, but we're gonna start out the morning with these guys. And these actually just came out of a fish I caught the other day, so they're about as fresh as they get.
So these are the liquid egg cure by Pro Cure, and then I've doctored them up with a little extra sulfite, make them a little hotter. And they're a little goopy, so I rolled them in borax this morning. This is our first trip for the year, so I wasn't sure what to bring, so of course I brought it all. If the fish are there not biting, we're gonna entice them. I'm gonna pour some of this in a pint container, dip my roe in this, give it a little extra scent. I brought the Chum Blast, which I can dip my eggs in that as well, and then I brought a good assortment of the different scents, but odds are it's gonna be Anna's Bloody Tuna and Salmon Slammer. But we brought 37 other ones just in case.
We're just starting to get going this morning. I have an electric motor, but for this application, we're kind of trying to go with the flow of the current. So I have to adjust a lot with my kicker motor because early in the morning, we got most of the wind is coming out of the gorge of the Deschutes River there. So you got to kind of face your rear end of your boat that way. And to get that bow mount oriented correctly, it's a little more challenging and to keep going with the current. So a lot of times I gotta be doing a lot of adjusting with my kicker motor. So it's just much easier to do it with the handheld motor. The goal is to pretend like this boat is a bobber. You wanna be going as naturally as possible with the current. So what you want is your lines to be perfectly perpendicular. You don't want any angle in your lines. You want everything just flowing exactly how it would as if it was under a bobber.
I'm guessing the bite's gonna turn on in about a half hour. As soon as that sun starts cresting the mountain range there, lights up the water, it's gonna go crazy.
So Don, I know you haven't done a ton of hover fishing, but just good knowledge basically is keep that rod as perfectly still over top of your baits as you can. The more you move, the more it drags your baits around. So just keep stationary as possible and keep your rod tip low to the water so you have room to set the hook and bring it up on the fish when they do bite. When you're floating down, you want to be about 2 to 3 cranks off the bottom, ideally 2. It's just, you're about a you're about 2 feet per crank of your reel handle, so it puts you up about 4 feet off the bottom. And we're running about 3 feet a leader, so it puts our baits right in that, about a foot to a foot and a half off the bottom of the river. Puts it right about where the fish should be. So, and even a little shallower is okay. 3 cranks is fine.
Yeah, you know if you're fishing too close to the bottom when you hook a sturgeon, they're usually right on the bottom. So ideally you want to hit bottom, bring it up 2 to 2.5 cranks, and wait for the salmon. But if you're landing sturgeon, you're too deep.
Up here at the mouth of the chute, you see a lot of different guys doing different techniques. A lot of times inside of here, you'll see some guys trolling plugs. There will also be guys trolling pro trolls and spinners, or pro trolls and super baits. It just depends on what the guy's after. But we start out hover fishing. It's just a method I prefer. It's just another tool in the arsenal, but I just like it because it's more lighter gear, more hands-on. It's a little bit funner to do, so.
Welcome back to the mouth of the Deschutes River. I'm Justin Wolf. Jason Hambly, Steve Lynch, Dave Ng, and Don New are not having any luck first thing this morning. But there's more than one way to go from zero to hero.
Okay, our sun is cresting over the mountain, so the bite should turn on any minute now. It's gonna light up the water, get the fish to bite.
So here in on this area here at the mouth of the Deschutes, they have an area that's a cold water sanctuary. It's for steelhead and stuff to seek refuge. It's inside of these white buoy markers that say ODFW. You're not supposed to fish inside of those. And so basically we're just kind of skirting along the edge of it, seeing what we can pick up. Kind of a slow start to the morning, but I'm not marking a lot of fish either, so I don't have a lot of high expectations at this point, but the nice thing about this is there's a lot of fish going up the river right now, and they can move in any minute. So, because sometimes they get cleaned out here overnight. It takes them a little bit to replenish.
Now, it's not very good to see only one fish so far.
Well, we're going to make a move. We started out here, and I was hoping for the best, but it seems pretty cleaned out and void of fish. It's about 8 o'clock, so we could probably stick around and keep pounding on it and hopefully a batch of fish move in, but I don't have the patience, so we're gonna move downriver and try to find some.
Well, certainly this isn't the first time I've been fishless for a couple of 3 hours on the river. It's discouraging here because you know they were here yesterday and not today. That's there's a relationship there with some of the fish that are caught in nets. So we're gonna move. I'm not sure where Jason's planning to take us, but we're gonna find some fish. He's kind of hacked off about this. He's not used to not even having a takedown. So we're on our way somewhere else.
We started up on the Deschutes. We just drove down here to the mouth of the Klickitat, and we're just putting out of the boat ramp now. We're gonna go down river there. And sounds like, talking to a guy at the ramp there, it sounds like there's a few fish. He marked a bunch of fish at the mouth of the Click, so we should be able to get into some there. Yeah, the Klickitat dumps in right here. This is another one of those mouths of the cold water tributaries that the fish seem to pile at. Unfortunately, they weren't up above, so we'll see if they're here. Well, it's nice to come down here. At least we got some fish on the screen now. That helps with the confidence.
Come on, Dave, get one. That's true. And you know what, guys? We need to do a dollar for the first fish.
There's my buck, Steve.
No.
You didn't fucking qualify it.
Not no shit fish.
That's a little pea-mouth chub.
Yeah, I just like chub too.
That's okay. You got to start somewhere, right?
Yes.
Chubs need love.
I love chub. go, Jace. You need to fish the tire guy, Friday.
Oh, came on.
Oh, it's going to be a bloodbath, you guys.
I was getting taps.
Fish finder's so loaded.
Are you two up, Jake?
Yeah.
We've trailered the boat from the mouth of the Deschutes River to the mouth of the Klickitat, which has turned out to be the right move for Jason Hambly and Steve Lynch of Procure, Dave Ing of Fisheng Products, and Don New, director of Hatchery Wild Coexist.
You need a net, sir?
Yeah, that'd be good.
Hurry up.
Yeah, up here in the main Columbia, up above the dam here, well, even below the dam. As long as you're out of Astoria, you can keep wild or clipped, it doesn't matter. So that was our first pass down here, and lost one and got another one, and from here all the way up is just loaded with fish, so odds are it's probably not going to take too long.
Okay, it's my turn. I called it. So I got the liquid egg here, a little bit of anisbody tuna, and some chum blast, so I threw everything at it. So let's see. Look at that smoke trail. That doesn't get me a sturgeon, I don't know what will.
That's one thing that's fun about the hover fishing is all the we run light tackle, and it makes it a lot more enjoyable than having all the heavy gear behind it and trying to dink with that.
See, that didn't come out, right?
He was saying that because he's fishing a jig, and a lot of people, when you're running jigs, they think you're foul hooking fish, but that's not at all true. They're very effective.
They're the ones that don't know how to fish with a jig.
Yeah. Just move back over, and there's a little pump in here where it kind of drops off into 25 feet of water, and the fish are kind of stacked in here, so just trying to stay on top of them.
Yarded in tuna style. He's ready. Jason hands me a tuna. What a sweet guy.
That's right. We let that one go as a tule. They're really not much good table fare. They come in kind of colored up, and the meat's not the best. So we're gonna try for another. Just luck of the draw.
So we get a variety of fish here, you know, the tules, and we're looking for upriver brights right here at the mouth. A little bit colder water. They could be either going up the Klickitat or just resting here in the colder water before they continue going upriver. So it's pretty good opportunity to look for anything, and then later on in the season the coho pile up here as well, so you know, you can come up here and twitch for those or forward troll. A lot of different options going on this time of year.
So the Klickitat River that dumps in here is all glacial fed, so a lot of times when you're in the heat of the summer or even the fall, it's puking kind of a silty color, and it's always a little off color in the summertime. And just like it is today. But it really doesn't affect us too much here because a lot of that water kind of hugs in tight to the mouth there. And out here, we're out of the muddy water. So all it does is help us a little bit.
Hey, Coach, I didn't hit it till the second tap.
Same as me. Yeah.
Now it's kind of sounding like.
Nice sound.
So I just want to know, my coach, Mr. Lynch, had said hit it on the second tap. So I'd had a couple, three of those through this stretch and didn't do that. On this fish, it went tap. On the second tap, I set the hook and it worked.
Just like a trout, right?
Just like Coach Lynch said. That's and it had quite a concoction of Procure on it. We used the dip, I used the little slammer, and it was a combination of a gooey bob and sand trip.
Thanks for tuning into this week's episode where we're fishing for salmon on the Columbia River at the mouth of the Klickitat River. Now, the basic idea today is to drop a bait of eggs straight down in front of the fish's face and hopefully they'll bite it. If there's fish around, they will. Now, here's the basic setup. The eggs that we're using are, well, they've been cured by Jason Hambly, probably most of them, and Steve brought some too, but they're basically these eggs. They're the Procure eggs cured with Fuse, which is the same basic recipe that my eggs are done with, that Procure does for the shop here, the Procure premium salmon eggs. So the only place you can find these particular eggs is at the Angler West store, and they're cured with the Fuse cure. We also sell this in the shops, available online. A really good cure for those upriver fish. The farther away fish get from the ocean, the saltier, the hotter you want your cure. Really good stuff. It does a great job in these local rivers and all the way up the gorge. Now, setting up, what you want to do is use a nice long leader, not too long, but a good 36 inches or so of leader with an egg loop. Now, if you're not mastered at tying egg loops, we sell pre-tied Brad's leaders with the egg loop already done, ready to go. Simple way to get that egg loop in the water and fishing. Now, on these egg loop leaders, Brad's uses some really good line for the leader material, the P-Line CXX, super strong. The fish's teeth is not going to cut this stuff. And also, if you do want to learn how to tie your own egg loops, it's pretty simple. It just takes a little practice. There's a lot of great YouTube videos out there you could look at, and be sure to look at some of mine. Go to the Angler West TV YouTube channel and subscribe. There's hundreds of videos there of instructional type, and then also hundreds of episodes. So please support us and subscribe to our YouTube channel. And then you just need to be able to attach your weight. You're basically going to use these little BNR sliders that are really a good way to go because they're nice and small. A little BNR slider, got the fish feel dual lock snaps that attach to the slider, and that's what you attach your weight to. And then it's a matter of boat control and getting that bait straight up and down. With a little bit of practice, you can really get on some fish. Now, let's go back to the mouth of the Klickitat River and see if we can't hook up a few more fish.
Way to go, Dave.
This could possibly be a world record. Said it actually feels like a pretty good fish. Pretty one.
It does.
Yeah, it does. Thank you, sir.
You bet. So there's up here, there's lots of different strains of chinook going to different tributaries. There's some upriver brights, there's some tulies, and some of the upriver bright, even some of these are holdover summer chinook. It just depends. But the tulies have a distinct look to them. They're a lot darker and just different whole, different body structure, and they smell funny. But you can tell, even if they have a little bit of bronze color to them, they're when they're not a tule, a lot of they're going to cut beautifully.
That might be a coho. You never know. I'm ready for a nap though.
I just hope they don't mix. Yes.
He's not quite ready, but he's getting close. He knows what's going to happen to him.
Well, it seems like here at the mouth of Klickitat, the average size is usually 8 to 12 pounds.
Okay, here we go. So we started out of the Deschutes. It was a bust because they gill netted it or drift netted it last night. No fish there. So we pulled out, came down to the mouth of Klickitat. Shoot, within an hour, had our five fish, and we're pulling on out.
Now there's four people and five fish, but one of those is mine.
Yeah. They're here.
These upriver brights, you can see that the eggs are, very small. So these are fish are traveling, Idaho. So they've got a long ways to go. And when we cut this fish, you'll see a huge line of fat on it. You know, that's the energy for it to carry it up the river. That's why they're such highly sought after fish are these upriver brights.
Hey everybody, thanks for watching today's episode. And be sure to stop by the Angler West store in Woodland, Washington. I'm sure we can help you catch more fish. And remember, without the sponsors, there is no show. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.